Now we've seen some of the tools used in cladistics for trying to infer evolutionary relationships. And the goal of this is to identify monophyletic taxa. Here's an example of a monophyletic classification. It'd be outlined by this red area. Species A and B share a single common ancestor. So that's the mono in monophyletic, is a single common ancestor. And so these are all descended from the same single ancestor. Now, if we're not careful, we may be dealing with a classification, a term that is incomplete. So if we were to have a term that included species B, C, and D, but it didn't include A, our classification would be said to be paraphyletic. It's incomplete. So classification is incomplete. And then the worst problem of a wrong classification is if we have two separate lineages that have been grouped together and we have some term that says, oh yeah, these are the mugwumps or whatever, and yet mugwumps, the two species we have put in our unit, actually had separate evolutionary histories. And so these classifications include multiple ancestors. Now, primates, which includes humans, are a good monophyletic classification. That term has been used in zoology for a long, 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 long time, and we still use it today. It's a perfectly good evolutionary unit. And this is because if we look at the family tree in the mammals, there are a series of orders. There's the flying lemurs, there's the bats, there's the tree shrews, and then there's this lineage coming down here that gave rise to what are now the fossil, the extinct primates, and then the modern primates. Okay? But all primates today, every time we use that word primate, we're including only those species that belong on this branch of an evolutionary tree. So let's look at a specific example, and I want to focus here on the primates because they are such a well-understood evolutionary group. So let's look at how you read an evolutionary tree. And the key thing we want to keep in mind here is we want to have species that are very, very closely related to each other by recent common ancestry. But to get a good sense of how close they are, the techniques require us to use an outgroup. And so in this example, our outgroup is going to be rabbits. Okay? So rabbits are way down at the bottom of the graph down there. And the fact that the branching between the rabbits and all those other evolutionary groupings is so far to the left, that means it happened a long, long time ago. Okay? The next group over here is the tree shrews. And then we have flying lemurs. And so then we get to the primates properly. Okay? So these are the modern primates. And we have here a series of different groups. As we're going to see later in the course when we look at the classification of the primates, there are lemurs and prosimians down here at the bottom. These split off a long time ago from what then became over here, the New World monkeys in this branch here, which split off from the Old World monkeys, and from them come the apes. And within each one of these groups, these Old World monkeys, these species are all more closely related to each other than they are to the apes. The apes are all more closely related to each other than they are to any monkey. And then the New World monkeys likewise. So these very short branches here mean a very recent divergence between species. The longer the branch, the farther ago this took place. Now, humans belong in the same twig and branch as the great apes. And so we have some very attractive specimens down here. And there's a very, very large degree of genetic similarity. We're not ready to do genetics fully quite yet, but these modern classifications are based on all the similar sequences in the DNA in our genomes. And we're very similar to chimpanzees, slightly less similar to gorillas, and even less to orangs. So because we share the most genetic material with chimps, we see the closest branch points are between chimps and humans. Slightly further back on the evolutionary tree would be gorillas, and even further back is the orangs. So there they are, pretty clever. So when we do this sort of thing now, And we make these different classifications using all available material, and that's going to include all the genetics that is present in coding all the proteins in the bodies of all living things, we'll find that the broad-scale biological classifications are fully consistent with the way we understand geological history of the Earth. And one of the things that's maybe surprising to learn is that 250 million years ago, all the continents were connected to each other in a vast landmass that we now call Pangaea. And at that point, see, South America was connected to Africa, was connected to North America, Antarctica, Australia, all of these things linked together. By 100 million years ago, there was some separation, but there's still a large landmass here of Africa and South America in Gondwana. And it was only in the tertiary in the last 60 million years that the modern continents fully separated. Now let's look at this period of time here in the Cretaceous period, where we have Gondwana and Madagascar, Africa and South America are still pretty closely linked to each other. And then they become separate 40 million years later. And we have a good lineage. These are called ratites. These are the flightless birds. These include things like kiwis, ostriches, emus, cassowaries, rheas, moas, etc. And they appeared on Earth back when all the continents were connected as Gondwana. Okay? After the continents split, then the rhea from South America was no longer in contact with the ostrich, was no longer in contact with the cassowary and the emu, or with the kiwi and the moa. Okay? But there could still be diversification because the cassowary and the emu had a common ancestor on Australia, then they could diverge. But we have the single lineage that gave rise and ultimately became separated because of the continental drift of millions and millions of years ago. And so this term, ratite, as a classificatory unit, is truly monophyletic. We use the term ratite to describe the six different species of recent flightless birds. They all indeed shared a common ancestor that occupied that huge landmass of Gondwana.